Good evening. A few years ago, the idea of Britain's entry into the common market had all the enthusiasm of a crusade. Today, as negotiations for our third attempt to join get underway, some of that enthusiasm has waned. What are the issues now that determine the hopes and fears of those who are pro and anti? Well, tonight, in a 50-minute debate, four members of Parliament, one Conservative and one Labour for, one Conservative and one Labour against, will put those issues before you. Well, the first speaker then for the common market is Duncan Sands, former Conservative minister and lifelong European, recently appointed by the Prime Minister as leader of the British delegation to the Council of Europe. Mr. Sands.
Well, there are two main reasons, I think, why we ought to join the common market. The first is that we shall be better off. This will give us an internal market of about 250 million consumers, about five times as many as we have today. The bigger market will justify much larger investments of money in modern machinery and research. And this will enable us to compete much more successfully with the industrial giants on the other side of the Atlantic. If we decide to carry on alone and paddle our own canoe, we will, of course, not collapse. But we will undoubtedly continue to lag further and further behind our European neighbors. 10 years ago, Britain was richer per head of population than all the countries of the six, with the exception of tiny Luxembourg. Today, we are poorer per head of population than all of them, with the exception of Italy. Now, whether or not we join the common market, the community, the European community, is going to go ahead. We can, if we wish, stand aside and watch the growth on our doorstep of a giant new power in whose policies we shall have no say. Alternatively, we can help to build the new Europe and share in its expanding strength and in its rising living standards. Leaving aside the economic issue, the other reason for joining is that it will give us much more influence in international affairs. Today, the big decisions which determine our destiny are very largely taken over our heads in Washington and in Moscow. On the other hand, if we and our European neighbors, who have so many interests in common, could speak with one voice, our views could no longer be ignored. For these reasons, I am quite convinced that, provided, of course, that fair terms can be negotiated, it is unquestionably to our advantage to join the common market and play a leading part in developing a united Europe. That, I am sure, is the road to prosperity and power.
Thank you, Mr. Sands. And now, to speak against entry into the market, Mr. Douglas Jay, former Labour President of the Board of Trade, Chairman of the Common Market Safeguards Campaign. Mr. Jay.
Well, what Duncan Sands, I think, doesn't realize, hard as he tries, is that the effects of this country joining the common market under present conditions and on the terms which we could now reasonably hope to get would be economically disastrous to this country. In the first place, this would be the main effect. We would have to buy the great bulk of our food supplies from overseas, which is half our total food consumption in this country, from high-cost, relatively inefficient farmers in Western Europe rather than from the most efficient and low-cost producers in the world, in North America, Australia, New Zealand, and the other continents. That would have two effects on this country. In the first case, food prices would rise very steeply, which would mean a higher cost of living all round for the housewives and the whole population of Great Britain. That would be in itself unjust and inequitable and would mean lower living standards for the British people. But that would not be the end of the mischief. It would also mean that we should have to pay more on the international exchanges for a very large proportion of our imports, and that our balance of payments would quite unnecessarily and gratuitously worsen for that reason. The next stage in the process would be that as the cost of living rose and wage levels inevitably rose, as we have learnt in recent years, that the cost of manufacture of all British exports all over the world would go up and our exports would go down. And all recent serious analyses of this problem have shown that on balance, this country would lose several hundred billions of exports more in the outside world than we would gain in the rather narrow area of the EEC. Now, Duncan Sands, if I may say so, is curiously wrong on the facts when he talks of the market widening. The market at present, of course, tariff-free, which British industry has, is not one of 50 million in this country. It is one of the whole of the EFTA group, which is 100 million, plus a very large area in the Commonwealth. And when you have worked out the whole sum, when you have allowed for higher prices for our food, for a loss of exports all over the world, due to higher prices on the one hand, and due to the loss of the free entry rights which we now enjoy throughout EFTA, throughout the Commonwealth, there is no doubt that this country would be much worse off in terms of its ordinary balance of trade. It would also have to pay some, probably of 500 or 600 millions annually across the exchanges to the common market's rather peculiar agricultural funds, which is really a polite expression for subsidizing French agriculture at the expense of the British housewife. And when you've added it all up, there is really no serious doubt that this country would be at about 1,000 millions a year worse off. That in turn would mean not merely a lower standard of living and a much worse balance of payments for this country, but it would also mean, because of the balance of payments deficit which British government would be faced, slower growth, stagnation, and less economic progress for this country. And that in itself, in my opinion, is a decisive argument against entering the common market on the terms which we could now reasonably hope to get.
Thank you, Mr. Jay. Now the second speaker in favour of entry, and I must ask him and the other one who's coming to keep to the time because we're beginning to overrun a little, Dick Taverne, QC, a former Labour Minister of State and Financial Secretary to the Treasury. Mr. Taverne.
Well, I think in this decision we face a very big decision. Many people have seen it in terms which are important, but like, say, the price of butter, but which are not the most important. To me, the most important decision is the political one. The six countries of the common market have been growing closer together. There's now no question of the kind of disputes and wars which rent Europe apart in the past, and they're moving towards a common approach in the big decisions which affect the world. And where does that leave Britain? Now, I think we have a choice between three possible things. One is to remain in isolation, one is to link more closely with the United States, and one is to join up with the common market. Now, I think the time is past for a posture of splendid isolation, because the really big decisions would pass us by. The big decisions about war and peace, the big decisions about the relations between the developing and the less developed and the more developed countries, and the big decisions on trade would be taken by the major powers, of which the common market would be one. Now, we could, I suppose, develop closer links with the United States. But we could never be on a footing of equality with the United States. We would be dominated by the United States. And it seems to me that the best course for us would be to link up with the European powers, who are roughly our equals. I welcome the political unity which is growing up towards Europe, and I would like to be a part of it. Of course, one could not pay too big a price. If, in fact, there was to be economic suffering or economic worsening of our position in the next 10 years because of joining the common market, we could not do it. And this, to some extent, depends on the terms. There are disadvantages in the field of food, but this, again, depends on what one can negotiate. But, in fact, I think that economically we would gain rather than suffer by joining the common market in the longer term. Because what does the growth of our prosperity depend on? It depends essentially on our fastest growing industries. These are the technologically based industries. These are the ones that need a large home market, that need a lot spent on research and development. And these are the industries which are keenest to see us go into Europe, because if they had a home market of 250 million people, they'd have a much firmer base for future investment and for the research and development. And if we didn't join the common market, then I would be afraid that the inevitable alternative would be more license agreements with American companies, links with American companies, more of our industries owned by the United States. And I come back to what I started with. It is not in any anti-American spirit that I say this, but I see our future with Europe, where we can be more equal. And I think that within Europe, we would have a greater part in the vital decisions that affect us all. And also, I think within Europe, we would find a faster rate of growth than we've been able to obtain so far outside the common market.
Thank you, Mr. Taverne. And now the last of our four speakers against entry. Neil Martin, junior minister in the last Conservative government and vice chairman of the Common Market Safeguards Campaign. Mr. Martin.
Well, I should like to start by thanking Thames Television for having this debate. It's a subject which this country must accept, must be debated on both sides. I believe, though, the debate may turn out, in reflection, to have been academical, because I simply do not believe that we shall get terms which will enable us to go in. But Dick Taverne was quite right when he said that this is not a question of the price of butter. It is not. That is a red herring, if I might say that about butter. But it is, as Dick Taverne said, entirely, really, basically a political matter. Because those who study the Treaty of Rome and who talk to the people in the Six and so on, they know that behind this Treaty of Rome, which is primarily economic, lies something called the spirit of Rome. And this, of course, is the drive amongst the Six to create a United States of Europe. Now, our leading politicians say that we needn't worry about this, that we shall make a pragmatic approach to it, and that we shall go at the pace of the slowest. But, you know, when we have statesmen in our country, and we have statesmen in our country, it is their job to look to the future and say, where is all this ending up? And this is what I must ask. Where does it end up? It ends up quite clearly with a European Parliament. There is one now, of course, but it will be strengthened. It won't just sit there twiddling its thumbs. It will go on, it will get budgetary power and so on. It will be directly elected, and in the end, it will vote on a majority vote. It will have a common foreign policy, a common defense policy, common social money, and even now they're talking about a common education policy. So in the end, this is what will rule this country, and the British Parliament will be reduced. And I do not say that this is exaggeration. It will be reduced to the status of a county council as we know it for. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is forever. You, in theory, it is a treaty without time, but in practice, once you're locked in, you could never get out. And therefore, I think we should have a referendum on it. The British have not got their heart in this at all. Britain has a greater role in the world to play than being locked in there. I want a wider, much more imaginative thing than this. A free trade area to start with between the Six and the Seven, and bringing in our Commonwealth. And I am determined that in these negotiations, our Commonwealth shall not be let down.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. Now, gentlemen, I want to have a brief statement from each of you commenting on what the others or other has said. And in view of the fact of time being slightly overrunning, I don't think you're going to have time to make more than one point each. Mr. Sands, would you make your point?
That's a bit hard, Dad. Well, first of all, I think it's I'll take up Neil Martin's point. I'm glad he said that butter, the price of butter was a red herring, because that's what the anti-marketeers have been campaigning on in the main. So far as political union is concerned, of course, there's no question of finding ourselves overnight in a European federation. Any step towards political union will require our consent and the consent of all the other countries. Personally, I'm convinced that the only way of regaining some control in world affairs over our own destiny and playing some part in shaping the course of world events is by joining with others and constituting a group which is sufficiently powerful, sufficiently influential to speak on level terms with the superpowers.
Mr. Douglas Jay?
Well, I'm grateful to Dick Taverne for showing that the main argument for entering the EEC, well-meaning as the people are who wish it, really rests on confusion of mind and ignorance of the facts. Dick Taverne used the phrase going into Europe. Well, it's hardly possible to imagine a more muddle-headed expression, since either we are in Europe already, which I had understood to be the geographical truth, or if we're not, of course, we can't enter it. Secondly, he talked about a larger market as a result of this exercise. He appears entirely ignorant of the fact that all serious analyses have shown that given the common agricultural policy of the common market, which Mr. Tony Barber on behalf of the present government has now accepted, it would be quite inevitable that if we were to enter on these conditions, our market would be narrowed permanently and not increased. Therefore, on the showing of Dick Taverne alone, the case for entering rests on ignorance of the facts and confusion of mind.
Well, there you are, Dick Taverne.
Well, Douglas Jay sees things very much in geographical terms. He sees things in geography. Because we are part of Europe geographically, he says, therefore, we are part of Europe.
Not
of course, politically, Europe is developing, and this is the important issue we have to face. Our market is decreasing. If we stick as we are, the Commonwealth market, which we have a certain preference in, is going to decline, and parts of the Commonwealth are going to conclude separate agreements with the common market, which in fact will erect a barrier against us. The EFTA market won't be as big because parts of the EFTA countries are likely to go into the common market in any event. The fastest growing element in this is the common market itself, and that is the market towards which we should be looking for our future policy of growth. So I'm sorry if I'm making points which Mr. Jay is protesting about, because they're rather telling. But if you look at the whole question of the control of British Parliament too, we would have control if we stayed outside within our own decisions, but they all become increasingly less important decisions. The real issue is, do we have a part to play in the fundamental decisions which affect us and which will be taken by the great powers?
Neil Martin?
I'd just like to make two very quick points. One was picking up Duncan Sands when he said that to enter the common market would give us more influence in international affairs if we could speak with one voice. If we could speak with one voice. You know the situation in Italy. The Italians could have a communist government, and it's debatable, but they could fairly soon. Can you imagine what sort of political unity you would have in Europe with one of the members sitting around your table representing a communist government? That's one point. The second point is Dick Taverne also said that he's prepared to enter if the terms are right. Fair enough. There are a lot of people like that, but I would point out to them that if that is so and they do enter, they must accept at the end of the road the political implications of it all, and that you eventually will end up with one country called Europe. Even if the terms are right, that is the end and logical end of the whole operation.
Gentlemen, thank you. Well, that is the end of the first part of this common market debate. In the second part, members of our audience here will be putting questions to the four speakers. We'll be back for that in just a couple of minutes.